Hey guys, what's up? My name is Beatbreaker, and in today's video I'm gonna show you all of the settings in BIOS to achieve a super stable and very robust 5 GHz overclock on the i9-9900k. Then we're gonna have a look at the temperatures that you can expect at this 5 GHz overclock. We're gonna look at some synthetic benchmarks as well as some gaming benchmarks, because I think that most of you are probably here to actually see what kind of gains you can expect when overclocking the i9-9900K while gaming. And finally, we're gonna look at the speed increases when rendering a 4K 60fps clip in DaVinci Resolve. Also, feel free to skip ahead to the topics that you're interested in via the timestamps that are provided in the description. Now, the system on which I will overclock this chip consists of a gigabit Oris Extreme Z390 motherboard. I have 32 gigs of DDR4 memory at 3200 MHz. We have the Kraken X62 AIO water cooler together with two Bionics P140 coolers by Arctic. And finally, I have the RTX 2080 Founders Edition by Nvidia. If you're interested in the build of the system, then definitely check out the video in the top right hand corner. Now, before we're gonna get right into the video, I'd like to mention two caveats. First of all, I'm by no means an overclocking expert. Everything that I'm showing in this video has been researched and kind of figured out by the help of other YouTube videos. I will link these in the description box below. So if I can achieve a 5 GHz overclock, you should certainly too. And if there is anything that you think I might have missed or simply have gotten wrong, then definitely tell me so in a comment section below, because I'm always keen to learn more about overclocking. And the second thing I'd like to mention is that on my specific board, the i9-9900K was actually already running at 4.7 GHz across all cores without me actually fiddling around in the BIOS whatsoever. So it was actually already running above that 95 TDP rating, and therefore going from 4.7 GHz to 5 GHz won't yield significant increases in terms of gaming performance. This is just something that I'd like to mention. If you're really only interested in gaming, then enabling XMP is basically all that you really need to do in terms of getting the most out of your chip. But with that being said, let's finally hop into the BIOS and figure out how we can run this chip at 5 GHz across all cores. So the first thing you probably want to do is go to the classic mode, because nobody wants to be in that very silly mode there. Go to advanced frequency settings if you also have a gigabit motherboard, and enable the XMP profile. I think this is really a very important step, and you should definitely first enable XMP, reboot your computer. So go to save and exit setup, reboot your computer, and make sure that it's actually stable with the XMP profile. Now, I know that not on every motherboard the XMP profiles, or rather not on every motherboard RAM combination, the XMP profile actually works. In fact, using the exact same RAM as I'm using right now on the Z270 motherboard per gigabyte, I wasn't able to actually enable the XMP profile. Now, if XMP is not working for you, go to advanced memory settings and manually set the system memory multiplier to probably something like 2400 and figure out which is the highest frequency that you can actually run your memory at. Next, go into advanced frequency settings, disable multi-core performance, and go to advanced CPU core settings. Now here you want to change quite a few things. First of all, we're gonna change the CPU clock ratio to 50 because we want a 5 GHz overclock. Set the AVX offset to 5 such that when AVX instructions are encountered, the CPU will be clocked at 4.5 GHz instead of 5, and this is needed as AVX instructions are very taxing on your CPU and make it run much hotter. Obviously, this might vary depending on your chip and depending on the cooling solution that you have. So you kind of have to figure this out on your own, which works and which doesn't. But if you're not even using anything like Blender or Handbrake, then the AVX offset is probably not gonna be very important to you anyways. TJ Max I'd like to set at 110 degrees. This is basically the temperature after which the CPU will throttle its core clock if it actually exceeds the temperature. And on-core ratio I like to set to 47, or basically 4.7 GHz. Now, the next step are actually optional, but I just like to set them to really make sure to get the highest possible performance out of my chip as possible. So I'm going to set both the short and long package power limit to the maximum values of around 4000 watts. Of course, the chip is not going to use 4000 watts here, but it just basically allows it to run as high as it wants. Also, I set the core current limit to 255 amps and disable all of the C-state supports to make sure that the CPU runs at the highest frequency all of the time. Next, you want to hit Escape twice, go to Advanced Voltage Settings, go to Advanced Power Settings, and set up the VCore Load Line Calibration to Turbo. Now, this is a super important setting, and if you do not set this, your CPU will most likely not be stable at a higher clock. So definitely make sure to set the load line calibration to Turbo or State 6, I think, on other motherboards. Additionally, I also like to set the CPU VCore current protection to extreme, as well as the PWM phase control to extreme performance, which basically just gives us a little bit more stability for our overclocks. Note that these two settings are optional and you don't really need to set them if you don't want to. And finally, you want to go into the advanced voltage settings once again and into the CPU core voltage controls and up the CPU VCore setting. In my case, I'm using 1.3 volts to get a stable overclock at 5 gigahertz and I get very reasonable temperatures. We're going to talk about this in just a second. But in your case, you might need to change this depending on your cooling solution and depending on the chip that you got. So maybe you can actually set this to a little bit lower than this, or you have to set it a little bit higher. Now, finally, I always like to save my profiles. And as you can see, I've already tried out a few different other things here. We're going to put it into this slot here, 5 gigahertz, YouTube. Save and exit the setup. As you can see, these are all the changes that I've made. Hit yes, and hopefully your CPU should now be successfully overclocked to 5 gigahertz on all cores, while at the same time being completely stable. Now let's have a look at the temperatures that I'm getting at 5 gigahertz. We're going to start off with the worst possible scenario, and that is when facing 100% AVX loads. So these temperatures result when running the IDA64 stress test in the FPU mode for more than 30 minutes. The green curves represent the individual core temperatures, the blue curve the liquid temperature, while the red curve indicate core frequencies as indicated on the right hand side. You can see that my core averaged around 75 to 83 degrees Celsius with an ambient temperature at 23 degrees Celsius. The maximum temperature on any core was 85 degrees, while the overall core mean was at 79 degrees Celsius. You can very nicely see how the liquid temperature slowly increased until it reached about 37 degrees Celsius. Now, reaching below 80 degrees Celsius on average at 4.5 gigahertz at 100% AVX load is, in my opinion, very reasonable. Next, we ran the Intel Extreme Tuning Utility stress test, which doesn't use AVX instructions, and you can immediately see how the average temperatures dropped. The average core temperatures only reached 58.6 degrees Celsius, whereas the maximum temperature across all cores only reached 71 degrees. And also note how the liquid temperature leveled off around 33 degrees. Note the frequent dips in frequency to 4.5 GHz indicated that AVX instructions were active in the background. Now, frankly, I'm not using any tools that primarily depend on AVX instructions, and therefore I decided to go back to an AVX offset of 0 to make sure that my CPU remains at 5 GHz throughout all of the time. Now, as you can see from this last stress test with AVX offset set to 0, the temperatures remain absolutely manageable while the core clock remains at a juicy 5 GHz. So really, with a decent cooling solution, temperatures aren't going to be a huge deal on the i9-9900K. Next, let's briefly have a look at a synthetic benchmark. Now, honestly, I'm not a big fan of these because I don't think they translate well into real-life performance. But regardless, let's have a look at TimeSpy from 3DMark. And these are the scores that I'm getting without any overclocks. So that's at 10,466 points. And the CPU is scored at 10,212. Whereas with the overclock, I'm getting 10,799 points and a CPU score of 11,732. And with that, let's move on to the long-awaited gaming performance. We're going to start off with Counter-Strike Global Offensive. And what I'm showing are results for both the i9-9900k as well as the i7-7700k at ultra and at what I call the competitive graphics setting. So first let's look at the blue bars, so the competitive settings, and by going from the i7-7700k to the i9-9900k, we can see that we immediately gain around 30 FPS without doing anything. No overclocking, no XMP profiles, that's just the base clock and base frequency of the memory that I'm getting with this specific board and RAM configuration. Now, interestingly, by simply enabling XMP, we can see a very significant increase in performance in Counter-Strike Global Offensive using the competitive game settings. So if you don't really want to overclock, then enabling XMP at least will definitely gain you a few frames per second. And finally, by applying the 0.3 GHz overclock, you can see that I'm getting 14 FPS more on top of the base frequency. Now, interestingly, using the Ultra game settings, the overclock does yield more frames per second compared to the increase by simply enabling XMP. Next, we have the results for PUBG, and here I only have results for the Ultra game settings on the i7-7700K. And once again, we can see there is a significant increase in performance going from the i7-7700K to the i9-9900K. Note that obviously the 7700K is quite significantly overclocked, and therefore if it was at stock speed, we would even see much larger gains here. Looking at the competitive game settings, we can see that enabling XMP yields significant increases in FPS, and that the increase in performance when additionally overclocking are once again negligible. So basically at 1440p and with these graphical settings, the game is already GPU bottlenecked. And considering that I have an RTX 2080 in my system, this is actually quite ridiculous. But I guess if I were to repeat these tests for 1080p, then I would get somewhat different results and I would get a much larger yield by going from 4.7 GHz to 5 GHz on the CPU. Now, if you want to see the gains that you get by overclocking the i9-9900K at 1080p, then definitely tell me so in the comment section below and I will make a separate video on that. Now, when looking at the results at Ultra, we can see that enabling the XMP profile yields about the same performance as going from 4.7 to 5 GHz on the CPU. So once again, getting your memory to run at the rated speed should be your top priority. And finally, when moving on to Battlefield 5, we can see that overclocking the CPU is basically pointless, if you're only playing Battlefield 5, that is, of course, because you're not really gaining any performance increase. On the other hand, enabling the XMP profile does give you a little bit of a performance increase. However, let's be honest, in a real-world scenario, you're never gonna notice that at all. Now, frankly, I was a little bit shocked to see this kind of insensitivity of gaming performance to overclocking the i9-9900K to 5 GHz. Really, the most significant gains that I saw was when running the memory at its rated speed, and therefore in the future I might want to invest into even a little bit faster RAM than what I currently have and see if I can get even more performance out of my computer. But of course, I'm not only using my computer to play video games on, I'm also using it to render videos like the one you're watching right now. Now, first, once again, we're gonna look at the render performance when having everything at stock, so I didn't use the XMP profile and I didn't overclock the CPU. As you can see, temperatures are obviously lower than in the IDA stress test. I'm getting around 45 to 50 degrees on average and around 61, 62 degrees as a max. And it took exactly 2 minutes 22 seconds to render this 40 second segment of 4K and 60 FPS footage. When overclocked, temperatures were obviously a little bit higher, we got around 65 degrees on average and 71 as the max. Now, the time it took to render this exact same sequence at 5 GHz was 1 minute and 39 seconds. So basically I was able to cut down the render time by about 50 seconds, which is definitely very noticeable and very much welcome considering a much longer render. So the overclock was definitely worth it in terms of rendering, however in terms of gaming the gains weren't really as significant as I would have expected them. Small note, I actually tried to go even higher than 5 GHz, I tried 5.1 and 5.2 GHz, however I was not able to get a super stable overclock. Now it was stable in stress tests, in IDA 64, Intel Extreme utility, as well as the Intel Burn test. All were completely stable, however when I would go into games, I would actually get lower performance with the higher overclocks, indicating that I would have some issues in terms of performance or basically that there was some kind of throttling going on. So I would actually get the best performance in games at 5 GHz, even if I would get higher benchmark scores in a synthetic benchmark. But that about wraps up today's video, guys. If you liked it, leave me a like. If you didn't like, leave a dislike. Subscribe for more content like this. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next video.